Now, as people are taking their seats, what I would love you to do is go onto Slido. Do the thing you're never supposed to do in a presentation and get your phone out. If you've never used Slido, just go onto slido.com and put the hashtag in, which is BTTF for Back to the Future. And the first question will come up, just a little practice to make sure you're awake, you haven't had too much bubbles or beer, but just let's see if it works. Wonderful. So we're going to build a little word cloud between us. It's fine. Come and take a seat. It's all good. So this is good. I'm just making sure that everybody is online. So we'll just give it a minute. You can see, I think in the room we've got over 100 people, so you'll see them coming through. So this is going to be interactive. So please enjoy the session, but we are going to get your opinion all the way through. So this is great. You've had a great day. Exhausting, I'm hearing up here. But it's fantastic on Slido as well that you will get a copy of what everybody's saying on Slido if you sign up as well, because it's quite good to see all of this stuff. I'm sure the LT team will love to see thought-provoking. Well, let's make sure we can keep that going now. So welcome to Back to the Future. So thank you for indulging us with Slido. Just before we get going, I just want to share a short video with you.
Hey, guys, you got to get back in there and finish the dance.
Hey, man, look at Marvin's hand. He can't play with his hand like that, and we can't play without him.
Yeah, well, look, Marvin, you got to play. See, that's where the kiss was the first time on the dance floor. And if there's no music, they can't dance. If they can't dance, they can't kiss. If they can't kiss, they can't fall in love, and I'm history.
Hey, man, the dance is over. Unless you know somebody else that can play the guitar. This is for all you lovers out there. I don't know.
Scram, McFly. I'm cutting in.
Earth angel, earth angel, the one I adore.
Hey, boy, you all right?
I can't play.
Excuse me.
Well done for Back to the Future. Come on, I know a lot of you. You had shoulder pads. Think of that time, shoulder pads, all those amazing things that were going on when that film was released. Now, why did we call the report Back to the Future? Well, I was lucky enough to co-author the report with Ghent over here. And I was also lucky enough to work with the wonderful Sai. Sai, please put your hand up wherever you are, who designed the report. She's over here. And we did go through a lot of connotations on the report, but we wrote it because we believe that this is a pivot point and that L&D is like that photograph where we're starting to become invisible, and it's our moment to get our strength and our passion like George McFly and get in there and do the job properly. And we're going to tell you why. Now, just before we do that, now I thank Cyan Gent in the room. I want to thank Nadia and Breed and the other members of the Towards Maturity team who are now under the wing of Emerald Works. And I want to thank Peter and Jonathan and the Emerald Works team too, who have allowed us to swim around in this wonderful data and look at what we can do to support the industry to move forward, because we really are at a pivot point. The other people that we need to thank for the report is our incredible ambassadors. You'll see them when you get the report in the back. They have been supporting Towards Maturity's incredible work for a long time, and we thank them for their work, and they will go on to have, I'm sure, long relationships with the Emerald Works teams as the Towards Maturity data goes on its next journey. And thank you to everybody as part of our community that have given their feedback, because this report has got data insights from both Qual and the Quan side. So it's a little bit different from what you've seen before, which is great. Now this year we have taken three research perspectives, and these are really important. So we've looked back at the last 10 years, we've looked at today, and we've also looked forward. And again, this is a first for what Towards Maturity has been doing. This longitudinal study that has been going on for over 10 years has now allowed us to do something much more advanced and talk about some of the predictability stuff. So that's where we've gone with this research. So we've looked at hindsight, insight, and foresight. Now, we can't share everything with you today, but we're going to share some highlights with you. Now, the amazing thing is that this year the data is richer and more diverse than ever. We've collected data from 83 countries. Nearly 80% of people that take part in the Emerald Works Health Check, formerly known as the Towards Maturity Health Check, are budget holders and senior people that are dealing with these big issues. And we also collect data from other sources, and we've included it in this report. So the data is as credible and as trustworthy and at that higher level that we wanted to this year, and that's fantastic. So we're going to start by looking at hindsight. And ultimately, when we look back at the last 10 years, the reality is investment has gone through the roof. We're in Las Vegas. We are spending like crazy on learning and development. In fact, globally, the spend is over $400 billion. But the challenge is we're in the red because we're not being able to provide that proof that we're so longing to find. And we're going to tell you why in a minute. Just before we do that, I want you to go to Slido and just give me your view on what you believe, looking back at the last 10 years, apart from shoulder pads, what do you think L&D should keep? So we're getting a mixture of a lot of things here. And as I say, you'll be able to see this stuff on Slido. So we're getting live insight in the room. And these are things that, again, we have seen as part of this research. But there is a confused message out there. There definitely is a confused message. Really interesting. We'd just let us get to just that 100 mark. So where are we? Well, when we look back at the last 10 years, one of the things that Towards Maturity launched in 2017 was the transformation curve. It was a pivot point in the progress of towards maturity. And there were four levels of maturity that were established. Now, where we are is we're actually at the moment, what the data tells us is we're in stage two. Now, the first two stages are transactional. So we're having impact, but it's not a transformational impact. It's actually impact on something, but it's not learning. The last two are where we're having impact on organizational performance, things like growth, transformation, productivity, and profitability. And let's unfold that a bit more. Now, I mentioned to you that we have collected incredible data. And I've also mentioned that investment has gone up. Now, investment has gone up in L&D resource, in content in particular, investment in digital, and many, many other things. But impact is going down. So this decline isn't new. It hasn't just arrived this year. We've been in this steady decline of impact for a number of years. But that is in contrast to high-performing, high-impact learning cultures. And what Ghent and I have done this year is we've refreshed all of the language and we've refreshed all of the models, because what we're seeing is some very different things. But slow and steady is winning the race. Now, these organisations are not the richest. They are absolutely not the biggest. They are diverse, and they make up between 7 and 10% of our study. And they do change, as you can imagine. Now, these are some of the reasons that we're unable to keep up. So these are things that are being reported as part of the study. And these are still prevalent, and they've been there for a long time. We're not shifting any of these challenges. And that's a real missed opportunity. What we're seeing in learning and development from the past is that we're dealing with things at a surface level, a transactional level, rather than a transformation level. And we're actually getting confused between access to learning and learning itself. So let's unpack that a bit more. Now, we've got massive ambitions in L&D. We want to do everything. So if we take areas like growth and transformation, what you'll see on here, and you'll get all of this information as part of the report, I'm not going to go through, and you'll be pleased to know, I'm not going through all the data with you. But what you can see in the pattern that we're looking at up here is that everything's a priority. But in actually achieving those ambitions and applying what we've learned and providing that proof, it's just not materialising. And again, this isn't a new pattern. So we're looking here at growth and transformation, and we can also look at productivity and profitability, and you will see the same pattern. We are seeing a few things that are increasing here, but you will see the same pattern over and over again. So what Ghent and I have been doing, in particular, in absorbing ourselves in here, is we've been in search for learning. We have found lots of other things, but what we're not finding enough of is learning and how it can make that impact. Now, what's happened is we have increased digital. So you can see the changes here from classroom, blend, and online. So we're now sitting with classroom being at 49 and it was at 55. So the shifts are happening, but they are slow. They are slow shifts. Blending is not moving enough. We absolutely know that blend can do so much for us, but it's not shifting enough for us here. Because learning is not learning if we don't include reflection or application. And we need to be very careful and not get confused between the two. Now, this is a really interesting landscape here. And what you can see here is, again, those three perspectives of classroom, blend, and online. And the organisations that are the biggest here have made more investment online. So you can see where some of that investment is going. And some of these things, you can understand it, but there is a significant difference in organisations. So digital is definitely helping with scalability, accessibility, some of those things. But with learning itself, there isn't one digital application on its own that is giving the impact we're looking for. But the way it's used can make a difference. And that hasn't changed for many years. Now, the other thing that we do, and we know that everybody likes this, and I know this is a complicated map, but we have been tracking for a long time the capabilities of L&D themselves. Now, there's three areas to look at in here on this spider diagram. So we're looking at learning guidance, we're looking at L&D intent and value, and we're also looking at the learning ecosystem, which is expanding. So the tools at our disposal are becoming even more sophisticated, but this is making people feel overwhelmed and under-equipped. And that's the number one extreme pain that's reported by learning leaders. Excuse me. Now, any of you that have noticed it out there, you will notice that the core skills are going backwards and not forwards. So this is another reason why we're not able to find that proof that we're looking for. So let's dig deeper and start to look at insight. Now, just before we do that, I would like you to go back to Slido and tell me where your most extreme pain is today. No surprise that. So this is a typical word cloud. The more people are saying something, it's larger. And again, these are very common things that as we've been going around and engaging the community and talking to people, I love spoon feeding, that's up there. Self-directed is up there. So we've got a lot of extreme pain going on. A lot of extreme pain. Thank you so much for that. Now, that pain is no surprise because we are dealing with the most incredible, fierce forces of change. These are things that are not in our control in L&D. And instead of riding some of those waves, we're pushing against them on a lot of occasions. And we need to be really careful with that because as the world of work changes, so must we adapt. And we're not adapting, we're not able to keep up for most of us. Now, I don't need to read all of these to you, but what you'll see in here is there's a very different world of work coming our way. Now, what this is really telling us when we think about us as the profession is that at the moment, we can't even hit a static target. And this target is starting to move. So not only do we need to hit it, but we now need to hit a moving target. And that target is starting to move quicker. And we've got to get used to that. We've got to feel. So when you know you've got to hit a moving target, you need to look at something in a very different way. Now, we did six explorations on today on insight and what's happening. So we looked at culture, we looked at leadership, we looked at impact, the ecosystem, the consumer learner, and we also looked at learning guidance. Now, I can't share all of these with you today because we haven't got time. And I'm going to highlight just a few things for you. But what's interesting about these six is that they are a full 360 degree view of our industry. Now, we've written this report to make sure that you can use these three research perspectives individually or together and be able to take them into your business to help you be able to move forward. But these six areas are interesting because what we've been looking for is, are we really adding any value? Now, I've mentioned that we've updated all the models. This is the first model that we've updated, which is the cycle of maturity and impact. So although as towards maturity, we looked at maturity, we hadn't looked at impact. So what's happening is the only place where we're seeing an impact at organisational level on growth, transformation, productivity, profitability, those type of things, which are the four critical levers of business, are when we see deep impact of behavioural change, and that is in level four. And let's remember, overall, we're only in level two. The only people that are in level four are high impact learning cultures. So it's really interesting. Now, to be able to get to the deep level, it isn't as easy as it sounds. We need to look at things in very different ways. different lenses, and we need to start with a different end in mind. So let's unpick that a bit. I'm going to share with you just a couple of areas. If we look at culture, we need to unleash the power to cultivate. We need to think about being perennial rather than annual. We need to be patient. We've lost our patience. We expect to do something one day and for it to arrive the next. Behavioural change doesn't work like that. It's at least 30 days, and if you read the academic research, it's around at least 66 days. And how do we do this when we let go? We need to make sure that we're much more evidence-informed. Every time we looked at this data, it became more and more apparent that high-impact learning cultures, those that were focused on that deep impact, were getting the traction that other people are not. In fact, they're the only angle of our model that are. And these things speak for themselves. They are not perfect. They have a lot to learn as well. But they are making a lot of difference, and they are getting somewhere, and they are sustaining that impact rather than losing it. So just another area here, and I can't read everything out for you, but in here what you'll see is this feeling of feeling overwhelmed and under-equipped. That's really important. Learning culture is very different to creating a course, and it does feel overwhelming when you have that pressure on you. But there's less of that feeling with high-impact learning cultures than everybody else. On every angle we looked at, they are just beating the odds and bucking the trend. Learning ecosystems are really interesting. When we've been digging into ecosystems, people tend to look at their digital ecosystem. What our research tells us is the people that do this really well look at the whole of their ecosystem, not just digital. Because when you do that, it allows you to uncover a lot of blind spots. If we look at some data in this area, again, what you'll see is those high-impact learning cultures are not perfect. But just to pick out one area here, reflection. If we don't provide time for reflection or educate people that just because they watch something, they're not learning, if they don't get a chance to practice it, it's not learning and nothing will change. It's actually, in fact, a waste of somebody's time if that's what they're looking to do. But only 7% of people on average are spending time on reflection. We've looked at all areas of digital. I mentioned that none of them are working. Lots of things are in exploration. 28% of people in the high-impact learning culture are spending 28% of their budget against 19% of their budget elsewhere. A lot of what high-impact learning cultures are doing is exploring with things like AI, machine learning, serious gaming, all of those types of things. But you'll see a lot more in the report. The consumer learner, we have identified 6 characteristics. I have a deep dive session tomorrow based on the same research. If you want to come and dig deeper, we can do that. But these 6 characteristics have come out of the data, and these can be nurtured. And they're giving us so much more. When we get people in the world of LQ, so there's an LQ like there is an SQ, an IQ, an EQ. When we get there, we not only deal with performance, we go much wider. We deal with well-being, diversity, all of those other amazing things that come with it because they are aligned. Now, I just want to finish by making sure that we do look forward. So, who is beating the odds? Now, just before we do this, behavioural change is difficult. Doing it at scale is really difficult. If you read the academic research, particularly McKinsey, people like John Cotter's work, the odds are 70 to 1. So they're not good odds to start with. But once you know those odds and you think about the things that you need to beat them, you can look at things differently. And those high-impact learning cultures are the only people that are beating the odds. Now, as we move forward, if we look at 2030, it is predicted, if you listen to PwC, the World Economic Forum and others, that only 9% of people will be in full-time employment across the world. Now, that is a very different target to hit than today. So the things that we've seen in the past are not going to be fit for the future. But what we are seeing from those cultures those high-impact learning cultures will be fit to help us. Because what we need to do is get leaders, learners, and L&D guide people together, and all of them can make sure that culture hits their mark. Now, I would like to know from you guys, what is the one thing that you think L&D should be doing differently as we move forward to the next decade? Actually, I'm going to pull out scenario planning there. I totally agree with anybody that is doing that. If you're not scenario planning now, then you're missing an opportunity. Amazing, lot to do. Lots and lots to do. Now, in the report, we talk a lot about the future. Now, if we listen to Dave or Rick and other people, we're moving to eco-organisations. Now, we have a desire to move that way, but today we're still, most of us, hierarchical. Now, there's no surprise that what we need to be doing with learning is have a heutagogical approach. And if you haven't heard of that and you're in the learning and development industry, you must get under the skin of this. Because it's no surprise that there is a connectivity between these two angles. We've also created a model which is for the high impact learning culture. And we need to sow the seeds of change now. Because if we don't, if we want to look back at 2030 and see a very different picture and beat those odds and not be in a negative balance, then we need to do things very differently. We actually need to do less better. Now, we've come up with six habits that we see that are practiced as part of high impact learning cultures. Now, these habits are related to the model and they're related to the patterns and trends that we see in the data for successful people. Now, just to close, innovation in culture trumps innovation in digital. Get under the skin of culture. It is hard, we have to hold our nerve, but once we do, we will absolutely beat those odds. Thank you.